In 2007, I happened to be surfing eBay when I was somewhat astonished to find a scarcely viewed listing for the complete sheet music to John Williams' brilliant score to The Empire Strikes Back. This particular item was a copy of Williams' 8-line piano sketch score in the composer's own hand, the very same music that was delivered to his orchestrator and ultimately the same from which a master score in all parts were generated. The centerpiece of the score is a 15-minute action cue that Williams composed to cover the Imperial Walker attack on Hoth. In many ways, this cue is the most brilliant writing of his entire career. It is among the most complex as well. Even by Williams' traditionally thick standards, this is an unusually complex cue. For years, I have wanted to do a deep dive into this cue, but until recently, I really lacked the musical capability to firmly grasp what was going on. Unusual to most Williams cues, and perhaps due to compositional time constraints, there were places where the orchestrator was more involved than he would normally be in a Williams score. I have also uncovered some moments where Williams changed his mind about the composition, altering, adding, or crossing out things he had previously written in his original score. I think many composers may find the fact that these changes exist somewhat surprising, with most assuming that Williams' masterful writing would work perfectly without alteration on the first pass. There is evidence to suspect that some of these changes were voiced by George Lucas. At other places, it was surely Williams himself who wasn't liking what he was hearing in the orchestra. Perhaps this would be a good place to start. On this very first page of the cue, Williams begins by establishing a warm bed of strings. A harp and two quiet winds join moments later. Yet in the album version of the cue, Williams decided to omit these two harp passages we just heard. Instead, the actual recording sounds as this. Perhaps he preferred the serene and uninterrupted sound of the strings and found the plucking of the harp to take away from the overall legato feel being presented elsewhere in the orchestra. It is also possible that the harpist didn't give as clean a performance as he would have liked at bar 5, and he taceted both sections to remedy this issue. Let's listen further a bit. We can hear that this string passage has audible gaps at these locations. At first, we don't see this represented in the sheet music. It almost sounds like a more accurate notation of the performance would be this. It could be the case that Williams simply announced changes similar to these at the podium. What is more likely is that the players were reading into these tenuto marks decorating the passage. The tenuto mark is the most situational of all orchestral articulations. Its usage suggests different things at different places. In a Rachmaninoffian sense, a tenuto means to stress the articulated notes slightly. It was a tool he used to gently shape his phrases. In this usage, it acts as a smaller accent, and most typically, one will find these markings in the strings. Of course, the most standard meaning of the articulation is to demonstrate when a note is to be held for its full value. Often with this usage, it is accompanied by a second note with a staccato mark. The first note is to be held for its full value, the second note is to be short, a very common premise in orchestral and jazz music. We can see Williams employing this exact definition of the Tenuta Mark later on in this queue. In situations where a tenuto mark is used in a sequence of repeating notes at a slow or moderate tempo, traditionally a stress plus a gap is implied. This will especially be the case if some or all of the notes exist under a slur, although it may be the case without the slur. I've found that European players will often over-exaggerate these tenuto gaps when compared to players of other regions. In a classical piece that I recorded in London, I was somewhat surprised exactly how defined each one of these chords were. I did anticipate a gap, albeit a small one, but I didn't expect this final result. I wonder if Williams was pleasantly surprised by the expressive nature of these gaps and decided not to correct them. Perhaps he intended them to sound in this manner all along. At the very end of this page, we see a simple marking ad low brass. Given Williams' specific note, I found myself somewhat surprised to hear the trumpets playing these chords. This is only a guess, but I infer from Williams' note that he actually meant to save the trumpets for this immediately upcoming melodic figure. Had I been orchestrating this, I would have done my best to honor this note, and I would have given these pitches to the trombones and these pitches to the French horns, and I would have omitted the trumpets. Thus, a moment later, when the trumpets arrive with this melody, it would be a more substantial change of color, which is probably what Williams was after all along. Throughout this cue, Williams makes substantial efforts to preserve a feeling of forward momentum in the action on the screen. One of the primary tools he uses to do this is the percussion section. Frequently, he uses the trio of the piatti, snare, and bass drums in full or fragmented marching patterns, almost exactly in the same way Shostakovich often does. Looking closer at this passage, we can see Williams continues the trend. But were you able to hear that even though the bass drum and piatti were notated, we didn't hear them? Let's listen again. As originally notated, it would have sounded like this. Maybe Williams omitted these two instruments because somebody in the booth suggested that the bass drum may compete in the same frequency range as the electrical hum of Vader's pod. And then the piatti would make less sense by themselves, so he took them both out. Or perhaps he felt the bass drum and piatti didn't dramatically match Vader's zen-like state as he came out of his meditation. Or perhaps he simply didn't like the way they sounded or were performed. By the way, extra credit to you if you additionally noticed that the two-note flams given to the snare drum were also taken out. Williams is very careful in his pre-battle writing not to tip his hand as to the ultimate outcome of the battle to the first-time viewer. Instead, through a series of clever modulations, he focuses his musical efforts on moving the action forward. Orchestrationally, he saves the dramatic brass fanfares for later on in the queue, and sticks to a mostly string-driven, somewhat militaristic texture. Dramatically, he acknowledges the present uncertainty felt by the rebels with his music. Let's examine the score where Leia is giving instructions to the troops.
The heavy transport ships as soon as they load. Only two fighter escorts per ship. The energy shield can only be open for a short time.
So you'll have to stay very close to your transport.
Two fighters against the Star Destroyer.
The ion cannon requires several shots to make sure that any enemy ship will be out of your flight path. When you've gotten past the energy shield, proceed directly to the rendezvous point. Understood? Good luck.
While one certainly gets the sense that Leia is a central heroic figure in the movie, it isn't clear if the instructions she is giving are ultimately going to carry the day for the rebels. Let's compare Leia's speech to a very similar moment in the movie Gettysburg. In this situation, Union Colonel Chamberlain is also giving desperate battle instructions to his troops, who are nearly out of ammunition during the climax of the battle.
We can't run away. If we stay here, we can't shoot. So let's fix bayonets. We'll have the advantage of moving down the hill. They gotta be tired, the Rebs. They gotta be close to the end if we are. So fix bayonets. Ellis, you take the left wing, I'll take the right. I want a right wheel forward of the whole regiment.
What, you mean charge?
Yes, but here's what we do. We're going to charge swinging down the hill. Just like we pulled back this left side of the regiment, now we're going to swing it down. We swing like a door. We're gonna sweep them down the hill just as they come up. Understand? Does everybody understand?
Yes, sir.
Okay, Ellis, you take the left wing, and when I give the command, I want the whole regiment to go forward, swinging down to the right.
All right, sir.
Move.
Did you hear how Gettysburg composer Randy Adelman's usage of D major musically foreshadows an upcoming Union victory? It is almost as if the music is soothing the viewer, telling them all will be okay. In contrast, Williams' usage of uncertain pitches, ever-shifting keys, dissonance, and general upwards movement clearly defines the role his music has to play in the scene. Let's take a listen to just how highly dissonant these low brass harmonies are on the piano. Some of them are borrowed straight from big band. As we have repeatedly stated, the primary function of Williams' music was to keep the energy building and the feeling uncertain. In Gettysburg, the music's role was indeed to forecast the Union victory and to highlight the formation of Chamberlain's brilliant idea to leave his defensive position and to use his bayonets to charge down the hill. This moment is often remembered as a critical moment in American history, and thus, dramatically speaking, Adelman's music makes perfect sense. Incidentally, if you enjoy this type of discussion of harmony and orchestration, you may wish to check out Stratosound's Harmony and Orchestration courses, each of which explores similar lines of thought in greater detail. Throughout the battle in the snow, the music is clearly scored from the rebels' point of view. At the first viewing of the Imperial Walkers, the music is strongly rhythmic, using several of the lower instruments in the orchestra in a deeply menacing, rhythmic fashion. We don't hear the Imperial March here, nor do we hear the epic choirs like at the presentation of Darth Maul. Instead, we hear dangerous sounds in the orchestra, almost like these soldiers are hearing the sound of the walker's steps far in the distance. A few moments before, we see and hear the uncertain calm before the storm. Williams, as always, is highly concerned with the general feeling his music projects on the listener, and he draws from his great musical toolkit only to reinforce the feeling he is trying to project. As always, Williams is very careful with his orchestration and harmonic choices here. As you can hear, the piano passage is full of dissonance. Indeed, no discussion of this cue would be complete without mentioning the clustery language Williams uses in this cue. For in many ways, this cue is unique in all of Williams' output, as it is extremely rare for him to be writing generally tonal music using such dense clustery. Where clusters are to be found literally everywhere in his scores to horror movies, usually his writing for traditional action scenes is more nuanced, pointier, and more triadic in fashion. It almost makes you ask the question, why did he use so many clusters here? Perhaps it was merely a subconscious recall of the success he had in his score to Close Encounters, a score he mentioned being very proud of, and which he had written just a few years prior. Maybe he found success in using clustery phrases in Encounters, and it was still on his mind at the time of writing Empire. Perhaps while writing this cue, he was listening to clustery classical music on his car ride to work. Maybe he just wanted to try his hand at incorporating some of these ideas into his upcoming recording sessions. I have a much more brilliant idea as to why he chose to write in this manner. In English, there is a word called onomatopoeia, which is broadly defined as the formation of a word from the sound associated with it. The buzz of a mosquito, or the splat of it being hit by a fly swatter, are types of onomatopoeia. Musically, there exists a similar idea. Ray Vaughan Williams famously wrote a piece called The Wasps, where he successfully explored the concept. Many other composers have tried to incorporate bird songs into their compositions. It is my theory that Williams was, in some fashion or other, using clusters to imitate the sound of the machinery used in the Imperial's mechanized infantry attack. The use of clusters was Williams' own way of contributing to the overall machine-driven tone of the soundtrack during these moments, and was his way of enhancing Ben Burtt's sound effects for the scene. The two were working in tandem here. Writing constant and dense clusters for the orchestra can greatly increase the difficulty for sight-reading musicians, especially those who occupy single chairs and aren't part of a section. Back in the late 70s, when this score is recorded, all parts were written by hand on sheet music paper. Whereas clusters are still very hard to read in perfectly rendered modern finale charts, they must have been infinitely harder to read with pen and paper notation. I believe the difficulty of these clusters got Williams into trouble during this session. Let's examine this passage, which involved the two pianists playing highly syncopated clusters in both hands at a reasonably fast speed. Here the clusters in the right hand are written out, while the clusters in the left hand are lowest possible clusters. Williams frequently will use lowest note piano clusters to enhance or as a substitute for low bass drum hits. Interestingly, in this instance, he moves the lowest cluster cymbal up and down a tiny bit, which seems to ask the pianist to do the same. Here is how the passage in question sounded. Ultimately, Williams decided to test it, or to exclude this doubled piano part, completely from the recording. It doesn't exist on the recording at all. Given how similar high-accented phrases exist all over the cue, I assume the reason was the pianists simply weren't able to give a convincingly clean performance of this passage, and Williams couldn't afford to spend any more time rehearsing it. He needed to move forward, so he simply tested the part. Confusing the pianists further was the fact that they constantly had to keep one of their eyes on Williams' conductor baton. Since no clicks were used, a healthy portion of their attention had to be focused on Williams' conducting pattern, in order just to be in time with the other musicians. Sight-reading their part and keeping an eye on Williams left almost no resources to look at their fingers on the actual piano keyboard. Puccini is one of the composers I spend the most time studying, and there are several reasons for this. Besides the fact that I adore his music, one of the most critical reasons is the accessibility of his orchestral scores, which are reduced for a piano. All of his major works exist in piano-reduced form, with sometimes the maestro himself doing the representation. This makes it much easier to quickly explore the harmonies he was using. While I do own piano reductions of other composers, like this copy of Stravinsky's famous ballets for piano, I find that the soul of Stravinsky's reductions to be lost at times. The piano simply doesn't sound enough like the orchestra to merit studying it in the same manner as Puccini's. It was almost as if Stravinsky was more convinced with covering every note and less concerned with making the piano sound like the orchestra as a whole. Puccini seemed more concerned with the opposite. A second reason why I love to study Puccini is he was a dramatist, just as Williams is. Puccini's music accompanied visual mediums in a way similar to how modern film scoring does. If you excuse the difference between opera being two people singing and cinema being two people talking, there are many similarities to be found. Puccini composes music in a manner that simply demanded phrasing from the conductor. Stylistically, the tempo changes each bar to accommodate the phrase, and Puccini notates many subtle tempo changes. If you were to instead play it to a click, it immediately loses all of its charm, and thus, his music flows in an organic and natural fashion. Williams carries on the same romanticist tradition. He composes and then conducts his music in a manner that is malleable, that moves. Through this practice, he can make minute corrections in his conducting pattern to not only sync the music with important moments in the score, but also to phrase the music. His baton serves two purposes, and the musicians of the London Symphony, who are used to following the conductor and used to live phrasing, offer a more nuanced and musical performance in return. As evidence of this, let's revisit the opening page of this cue. Even though we just listened to it a few moments ago, it was easy to miss just how much tempo movement there was happening. I'm going to use my pencil and to do my best to follow along with the dramatic tempo movement in this passage. As you could hopefully witness, despite my poor conducting, there was a great variety of tempos used in this phrase. I feel sometimes that this type of organic motion, these moments of miniature rubato, are too often missing from modern film scoring. During the session, producer George Lucas and director Irvin Kershner would have been in the booth listening to Williams' score being played, and perhaps at times giving notes. In fact, some of the notes we have already addressed might have been requests from them. I believe I've discovered a few places where changes to the sheet music can confidently be attributed to them. There are two instances in this cue where Williams abandons his carefully written dynamics from his pencil-written score. Normally, changes of this type would never even cross a composer's mind, since careful thought had already been spent considering the subject. One of these times is during Leia's speech, the same piece of music we looked at earlier. As you can see, Williams originally notated a decrescendo, which would have seen the musicians of the London Symphony coming down to piano by the third bar of the phrase. Perhaps while composing, he was aware that his music may have interfered with the important dialogue of the scene, and this was his method for compensating for that. Here's a demonstration of how it would have sounded as written. It is my guess that upon hearing this loss of energy, Lucas requested Williams to remove the decrescendo and to keep the energy level consistent. About a minute later, as the rebels are preparing to fire the ion cannon, William presents his iconic triadic flourish heard so frequently during the Battle of Yavin in Episode 4. In the sheet music, Williams has the trumpets and flutes marked at forte, but it sounds much softer than that here. This obviously was either a note from Lucas to move out of the way of the dialogue or to temporarily bring the energy down so it could swell as the cannon was fired. Again, it would be less likely that our composer would have such a sudden change of heart over something that they had previously considered so deeply. When I was preparing for this video, I found dozens of other interesting topics that could have been chapters or videos of their own, like how the most important motifs of the asteroid chase exist within this cue, or how Williams discovered the main idea behind the theme to Bespin while writing this battle scene, but perhaps those are topics for another time. If you enjoy the videos of this channel, please consider supporting our work with a like or a subscribe, or by purchasing one of our courses at stratosound.com. Thanks for watching.